Mini Chapter 13, Jaymi's Games, The Imagination Thief, and The Host in the Attic. Confidential, though, the Platinum Raven is, some awareness of it continues to seep out along certain tendrils of the industry grapevine. Jaymi has avoided approaching any actual employee of Bang Dead, and the freelance talents he has hired have all signed non-disclosure agreements with him, of course. But from the fragments of industry chatter he has caught, he is pretty sure Dud and his fellow Dreary Ones have pooled enough information to know the identities of many of those talents, from whose known specialities Dud will have been able to extrapolate a rough list of what creative elements Jaymi's project must involve in terms of artwork, user interfaces, storyline methodologies, audio design, and the rest of it. To those mainstream eyes at Bang Dead, this list of creative talent may well look a bit strange in its balance. In the context of the talent's known caliber, many of the Dreary Ones will know enough to find the list quite curiosity-whetting, too. A few of them will even know enough to find it troubling. Why, Dud himself will be among those few, most likely. Troubling because they'll know to sense this game may just be a game-changer. For these are the folks whose instinctive use of the top-flight creative talent at their disposal is to put it to work building a close variation of the most leadenly guyish first-person shooter games already on the market. So expensive in their polish, with all the potential of that polish harnessed to serve content whose intellect and emotions are so unevolved. But much worse than that, these are the folks responsible for Ain't They Freaky. Against this warming backdrop of trust and originality, Jaymi's work on the early stages of the Platinum Raven proceeds well. In fact, he has found himself dealing with so much raw material that he's even had to start sketching out two further games in order to find homes for it. These he has named The Imagination Thief and The Host in the Attic. They are both at earlier stages of development as yet, but the very process of naming them has clarified something essential about the alchemy of all three titles. Through these solo sessions of hammering away in this crucible of a study here on Electra Drive, he is creating high-voltage beasts through which to conjure up various kinds of viscerality he wouldn't be able to inflict in meat space. After all, if a human is aiming to make any worldly progress, then much of their own viscerality will tend to need concealment. But a beast's won't. Most progress has been made on the Platinum Raven, though, where his design for Amber is coming into fastest definition. On the simplest level, this character embodies Jaymi's urge to respond to the Dreary Ones with fitting vengeance for all the hatred and close-mindedness that'll be fomented by their blockbuster tabloid news game. Yet, even at its most oppositional, it looks as if Amber will also evoke a flicker of sympathy, alongside the awe. Day by day, Jaymi can feel an increase in his own emotional investment in him, as a creator towards his creation. Okay, let's face it, Jaymi is starting to develop a crush on Amber. This beast's willpower is so strong, though. Might he therefore challenge his creator, asserting a selfhood all his own? Well, yes, there is a degree of danger here. Amber's personality does have its own volition. It may take off in strange directions, or swoop around at any moment, like a goose's neck, and target Jaymi in sensualized self-damage. Ah, it's a dangerous business, this beast building. But it has to be done, and it seems he's the man for the job. Throughout his dark hammering at the keyboard, deep into the night of his creating Amber out of nothing, Jaymi has a gathering sense that this is the calm before a thunderstorm. Shutting his eyes, he thinks hard, trying to identify what storm he can be sensing. He cannot tell for the moment, but the more he develops his game, the more confident he is that it will expand into the unexplored potential of the video game as an artistic medium. As a response to the world, his game will be as complex and as sublimated as anything found in film or literature. Its characters will be at the opposite end of the scale from those designed by committee characters, whom Jaymi has too often seen being designed by committees, while he was sitting in some conference room, groaning inside himself at the committee members' stiff, fearful, knee-jerk adherence to society's stalest and most creatively retarded concepts of what men and women could be and should be. Yes, he was quite the innocent when he first came to LA. What misbelief there was in him then, that the Dreary Ones were not, in fact, as dreary as their very name tries to warn one they are. That misbelief caused him to misread numerous small interactions over the course of his career in the company, construing many managers' motivations as being so much more evolved than he now sees they were. Yet, how valuable that innocence also was, and still is, for he continues to harbour its essence, and his nature is such that he will retain that essence for life. It cannot and will not be degraded in him. This is the simple secret sauce in his mission to reinvigorate the medium and the industry. Sure, it's a tall order. It's dirty work, frankly, but it would seem to fall to him. And here he is, doing it, approaching the job at hand with a bit of the old right foot, left foot, right foot technique. On the terrace of his promontory here on Electra Drive, he raises his glass to the night, takes a sip, and scans the grid of lights ahead, above which he feels he is floating. "Are you ready for this?" he asks LA aloud. A siren wails far across the city.